to the 10th Z Jaipur Literature Festival, and this is the Samvad venue. Before we begin the next session, just a polite note, if you have any mobile phones, please switch them to silent. Please feel free to take photos, share them on social media, and your various comments. Our official Twitter handle is at Z Jaipur Literature Festival, and our hashtag is ZJLF. At the end of this session, we'll be doing a 10-minute Q&A. Please wait until the microphone gets to you before you ask your question. We are now delighted to welcome, to introduce session number 50, which is Aspire, the Freedom to Dream, with Mridula Koshy in conversation with Puneeta Roy. Mridula Koshy is the author of short stories as well as novels. Her most recent novel is called Bicycle Dreaming, which is an exploration of family life in a waste worker community in New Delhi. She also works as a community organizer, building libraries in communities that do not have access to books. She'll be in conversation with Puneeta Roy. Puneeta is the managing trustee of the Yuva Ekta Foundation. She's been working on self-empowerment and healing with young people from both marginalized and also privileged backgrounds for over a decade. So please give them a huge Samvad welcome to the stage.
Hello.
I know.
Is it comfortable?
Yeah, it's fine. Thank you. I think that's Rishi Kapoor arriving there. All right. Welcome, everyone, and thank you for tearing yourself away from the front lawn. At least you get a place to sit here. But all right, let me just start straight away. This is a series that we're doing every day at this time slot, 12:30 to 1:30, at Samvad, called Freedom to Dream. Freedom to Dream is one of the themes of, all the work that Teamwork's doing, and it's one of the themes of this year, keeping in mind that it's also our 70th year of independence. So today, the focus is on aspirations, aspire. And I think Mridula is, I couldn't really find a better person than Mridula, who actually symbolizes her aspirations, her writing, her expression, keeping in mind with her growth, her philosophy that's been growing organically, reflecting in her writing, in her work, in her life. And it's amazing how you've integrated it all, Mridula. So I want to just start by asking you that something that's interested you is about the nature of storytelling, you know, about how do we choose our stories? You've written 3 books right now, and I'd like to go back to the first 2 books. The first was one of short stories called If It Is Sweet, right? And the other one is Not Only the Things That Have Happened. Can we start by asking you what made you choose your subjects in both these books?
Okay. Yeah? So I was born and raised in Delhi.
Right.
And left not only the city, my home city, but also the country when I was about 15, almost 15. And I was gone for a good long spell, about 20 years in the United States, came back more than a decade ago. So when I landed back here, something I think that I'd probably somewhat actively resisted all my life, something that was told about me in my family because of the specifics of my family, and this thing is that I was supposed to be a writer. So if you've grown up hearing you're supposed to be something, there's always the possibility
to rebel,
that you will push against that.
Right.
Because it's hard to know who you are if you're always at the receiving end of a description of who you are. And I think this is basic to anyone who writes, but also to just about all of us. In as much as we're thinkers, we're trying to figure out who we are. So I'd long resisted this, landed back in my home city. I'd left as a child on my way to sort of young adulthood. But 20 years is a long time, and in that time, Delhi had changed so much. I remember the drive to the airport when we left.
Which year was that, Mridula?
1984.
Okay.
And
that was pre-liberalization.
It was pre-liberalization, and it was Palam Airport back then, and it was just all empty. There were no cars, and I remember it was,
you know, it's almost village, like Palam village, yes.
Yeah, it was, and one or two planes took off and landed every day internationally, and we kids would know which ones they were, Pan Am or American Air or whatever, because there were so few to recognize. So anyway, that drive in that wasteland and then coming back, and it was just a very different city. So writing became something that I was interested in as a way to grapple with getting to know the city, getting to know myself in the city, whereas it had not made sense to do it before. We're in a literature festival, we're celebrating writing, we're celebrating readership. I think that's really what we're doing. I was a reader all the years. I wasn't a writer. I'm still a reader. And that to me seems like that it was then and it continues to be enough. I don't think it's necessary that everybody write. And it was part of my resistance to the idea of writing was, why? I mean, there are so many other good and important things to do.
What were you doing before you became a writer?
I worked as a trade union organizer in the United States for a few years. I worked as a community organizer. And most recently, after about 10 years of writing, I've gone back to community organizing. So this work I do in trying to get a library movement going in Delhi, from where I hope other cities, and there are parts of India in the Northeast, in the South, where there have been library movements, there have been literacy movements, and the two are sort of, they go importantly and strategically together. Functionally too, I mean, if you achieve literacy but don't have books to read, you can actually lose literacy. But in Delhi, we haven't had anything like that. In many, many parts of the country, we haven't had anything like that. And when we talk about the importance of readership, we need to sort of say out loud, because it isn't said enough, and therefore we pretend it isn't true. We need to say out loud that most people in India are denied access to reading.
To reading.
They may have access to functional literacy, which means they go to a school, perhaps a government school. The Constitution says we are guaranteed free education to a certain point. So we go to that school, we learn how to read, and we learn how to read so that society can find us useful in a very specific way, whether it's to turn on, you know, the machine at work, or to follow a script in a call center. These are the kinds of jobs that functional literacy can equip working class India for. And that's pretty much the majority of Indians in this country. There's very little done to make sure that people have access to books as a way of thinking. And that's very different from having access to textbooks as a way of learning to read, as a way of then using the reading to operate
true,
a machine.
True. So that gets into the thing that there's never just one answer, right? When you're saying it's a linear way of thinking in a classroom, you know, you're just going by the textbook, by rote. But when you're getting them to think, you can get...
Absolutely right. It isn't just that literacy is functional. It's also that it's only functional. It's also that I think our curriculum... we inherited this curriculum, but it has been 70 years.
Yeah.
We could do a lot more to look at how the curriculum does and does not allow for thinking, critical thinking, to develop. Ultimately, we need a population that's equipped to do critical thinking, because that's our citizenship. Unless we are thoughtful in how we exercise our citizenship, unless we have the experience of being thoughtful. So what our curriculum does for us is it... yes, it emphasizes rote memorization, which in turn is all about the idea that there is a finite amount of knowledge in the world. Knowing what the third largest stadium in this country and the first largest in the world, these sorts of discrete pieces of information.
And the dates of battles and mutinies.
The dates of battles, mutinies. Arguably, history is important, but there's you know, as we know, there was a recent controversy with the kinds of things that are being left out of our history, the history of Dalit resistance. So anyway, even being able to, in a classroom, look at the history that's being taught and being able to say, wait, is this all of it? Is there more? What about my story? What my parents have told me? I sense something is missing, or I disagree with this piece. That's absolutely not encouraged, because rote memorization is always about preparing you to grapple with these key pieces of information. And it's never about getting you to think. Whereas if you are reading for thinking, you're actively encouraged to understand that any and every question has as many answers as there are people equipped to engage with the question.
Yeah. So, Mridula, I want to just, I mean, we've jumped into the library bit. I want to go back, actually, you know, when you're talking about critical thinking and the interesting thing of you being a trade unionist before you got to write, right? You weren't writing then. So you came back to India. And your initial two books somewhere reflected your experiences and your engagement with the city. I mean, and obviously when you came back, you could, you had like a bird's eye view of the city that you had left. And you could see the changes that had happened in 20 years.
Yeah, a bird's eye in as much as I had a lot of distance. I really didn't know my city anymore.
All right.
And like a lot of migrants do, like a lot of immigrants do, you leave something and then it stays quite static in your mind. We know this from Bollywood, that NRIs, a lot of whom are the audience for our films, have very specific requirements of our art forms and of Bollywood, that it portray India as they know it. And meanwhile, we change and we move on here. So I was one of those people 10, 12 years ago when I landed back here. I expected an India that I had left behind, even though, I mean, cognitively, logically, intellectually, I was grown up enough and had sort of enough faculties to know it would be different. And certainly lots of people, my siblings who still live in the United States, were all about, you know, why are you going back? It's going to be so different. And, you know, you should get rid of your fantasies and so on. So when I came back,
so why did you come back? Why did you come back?
Why did I come back? Because I never got over leaving.
I think,
you know, we are all kinds of different people, and the kind of person I am is a person who just can't leave. And I grieved a lot. It was just a personal kind of me thing that, you know, the comforts of whatever living there and so on never appealed to me. And then the other half of it is, and how I became a trade unionist there, how I worked as a community organizer, has to do with my politics.
Right.
So I have politics around class. I have moved from being a comfortably middle class Delhiite in my upbringing, my father was a civil servant, to being a member of the working class in the United States. And I have experienced the kind of systemic oppression and exclusion that I, for example, that Bollywood will not celebrate. You know, when Shah Rukh Khan sits in a cafe sidewalk and sips his Starbucks or whatever, that is not the life of most of us from India who go and work, not only in the United States, but all over the world. I mean, we have a huge diaspora. Most of us are working class people when we leave here.
Right.
So I came back with a certain class perspective and politics, right, and that became part of my engagement with the city. I came back with what you call the bird's eye view, which is to say I had a lot of distance, which is very useful in writing.
Yeah.
You have to be able to step back to see, and then when you see, you have to be curious enough and disciplined enough to want to engage with what you have seen. And it has to strike you somewhere along the way that writing is a way to engage with it.
So that's when your genes kicked in.
I hate that. See, my parents told me this because I have an aunt who's a writer, and I grew up hearing that it's like a visitation, that it'll happen, I'll be possessed and need to write, which mystifies writing in a way that frightened me. Because if it's not in my control, if it's something that comes to me unbidden, then I'm not sure I can do with it what I want to do with it, what I am. If it's a sort of a blood expression or a gene expression, if it's my grand aunt, the poet in Kerala, talking through me, I'm not sure she'll say what I want to say. So it's one of the reasons I resisted writing, and then it really took sort of seeing that I had no other way to grapple with the city. See, I would have liked to have landed back in the United States, I mean in India, and continued
your work
to the work that I had been doing,
yeah.
Which wasn't possible.
Which was on social change.
Which
and
was
engaging
about social
with,
change. And it's okay. Only some 10 years into living here that I have gone back to social change work with the library movement work I'm doing now. Some of it is frustration with writing again. I've written 3 books, and I look around, and it's wonderful to be in this town, in this festival, and to see the thousands of people streaming around, to see that all of you are, like me, readers and interested in the project of literature, which is ultimately the project of, like, what my son calls the great human project. It's who are we, what are we doing, what do we want to be doing, what's stopping us from getting there.
You spoke about the process of writing, being scared about it not being a visitation. What is your process? I mean, you've got...
Oh, I think it's a job. You sit down at your table and your chair and you
but
have
the stories, the selection of the stories, they've come from your experience.
Well, I hate to demystify it so much that it becomes mechanical.
Yeah.
I think it was Paul Beatty said yesterday, it's very hard to give advice about writing, or at least to describe writing in a way as an offering of advice, because there are so many different kinds of writers.
Yeah, but your process.
My process is, I treat it like a job. I show up, I sit down. One of the first things that happened to me as a writer is I was looking around to try to figure it out. I met a writer who was very kind. It was at a workshop, and he said, the carpenter doesn't wait for inspiration. The carpenter goes to work every day, and some days the work is inspired and other days it is not. And for me, that's what writing has been. So I had younger kids when I was starting out. They're older now, so I wouldn't get to my writing desk or whatever. I didn't even have a writing desk, but I wouldn't get to my notebook till about, say, 11 or 12 after the laundry and the kids caught the school bus and left the house. And I would write till 4 or 5, and I did it 5 days a week. And then, you know, incrementally it got to be more and more. I was never a Saturday-Sunday writer. I was never a middle-of-the-night writer. I always had, like, a very
structured, sort of disciplined approach.
And as a community organizer, I'm a 7 days a week.
Right.
I work around the clock. I was taking phone calls related to work till I walked on stage.
Yes, yeah.
And it's partly because it's a startup right now. I hate to use that kind of corporate language because I'm opposed to the ways in which corporate language reduces us. But just as a way of communicating to you, that frantic pace that we're used to thinking of when we think of startups. What I'm doing right now, it's new, it requires round-the-clock ministration. So I do that. I do that 7 days a week. But for me, writing, no, it was, as much as possible, it was a job I did. I approached parenting the same way.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about your parenting. You mentioned the children. So you are also an adoptive parent. And some of that was your second book. Not only the things that have happened, right? What were you trying to express through that? I mean, what I find really fascinating is what you've actually lived through then finds expression, and it's obviously it goes beyond what you've experienced, but it's a trigger, it's a catalyst.
No, I think we draw on our experiences when we write, but more than that, I think we draw on our curiosities. So the most autobiographical I can be in my writing is chase my question, chase my curiosity. Try to figure out an answer in writing. Yes, I'm an adoptive parent, but I mean, my child asked me about my second book, is this my story? And I said, no, it's not your story. So though it came from my experience in that as I interacted with the sort of structures that are in place for how people adopt children, and the way in which adoption is always about people without power in relationship with people who have power, so that the people who adopt, the first world adopts from the third world, the upper class adopts from the working and poor class. It is never the other way around. There are, along with other criteria like, you know, sort of the social worker who comes to the home and visits will make sure that you have an adequate amount of furniture, a bank account. You do have to file your paperwork related to how much money you make and so on.
Amount of mental stability. How they gauge that, I don't know, but yeah.
Yes, I mean, it calls into question a lot about what we're doing in adoption. So if we're going to require that people meet certain income criteria and so on, but in addition to how adoption is structured, there is also the narrative or the story of adoption, which I think is problematically heavily romanticized. It's all about saving someone. It's never about the loss of the person.
You mean the biological parent? Yeah. The loss of the parent?
Not only the parent, I would argue the child. The child loses a lot. The child who leaves this country and goes to another country, or this one part of this country and goes to another part, I think people, part of the romanticization involves also the argument that day one in a child's life, or day 60 in a child's life, or at the end of year two in a child's life, the child is somehow still a blank slate. I don't think at day one any human being is a blank slate. That's you could almost say we need a whole other panel discussion to get into the psyche of the newborn, the inheritance that she leaves behind when she goes to another place, where much is gained, much is also lost, where the story does not allow the loss to be accounted for. There are silences that are painful. So my second book was more about pursuing a kind of critical thinking and curiosity, and really not at all about the actual autobiographical experience of adopting a child. But in the process of adoptions, the questions that were raised in my own mind about, is this right? Is this the best we can do? Are we really saving people? Would it be better to maybe have a system where people who are too poor to keep their children, and that is the only barrier to keeping their children? Because, I mean, I will throw out one statistic. The vast majority of children who are adopted are not orphans. They are not without biological parents. At least one, if not both, multiple biological relatives who have great anxiety to keep the child, and when they lose the child, to know where the child is going and if the child is well. And there is only silence in response to this anxiety. So I think much needs to be done to reform that. Fiction is one place to engage with questions. It may not always be the right place to engage with reform, because it's not about writing a political doctrine or policy. Novels are not policy manuals, but we can certainly pursue questions that may then strike other people in reading as fodder for policy. So
this sense of loss that you're talking about, I mean, just seems to reflect what you may have felt when you left this country. And
oh, sure.
You know,
I think it's very difficult to get through life without experiencing loss somewhere. I think I'm speaking for other people in the audience too when I say that. So
yeah.
I lived for many years without my own parents, because as many immigrants do, they went ahead to make the way and left us behind. And at times we were in institutions, and at other times I was with family members, and there is marked difference between those experiences. So when I found my way to adulthood, I had enough share of the kind of baggage most of us accumulate by the time we're adults. I was in another session yesterday, a Kannadiga writer who has been writing an awfully long time and has, I think, something like dozens of novels to his credit, and he was talking about burying his siblings when he was a young man himself. Not burying, I'm sorry, cremating. So some people have losses that I can hardly imagine, so I'm eager now to read his books in translation, because I imagine that's one way in which I can imagine
And
if I write about loss, it's because I think other people have grounds from which they can relate, and then perhaps imagine their way into what I'm talking about.
Okay. So, Mridula, while you were writing, you were also volunteering at the Dipale School as a read-aloud volunteer. Yeah? And that actually, I mean, the response there prompted you to, I read about the school closing and then you sort of went forward and said, let us open this community library. Can you share a little bit in detail about how the community library came about and what is the model that it runs on?
So way back in 2008, my partner, who's just a wonderful man, was out in the world. He's a school teacher, and so he was out in the world volunteering in this NGO
called Dipalaya.
Which is a wonderful NGO. Yeah. Doing good work, and I had a year of like feeling guilty at home, like I'm not doing this with him, because honestly I was frightened and lazy and didn't want to make room in my life to deal with those things and to actually go there. A year into watching him teach English and things like that at the school, all of which I said, oh, I can't do that, and he was talking to teenagers and I thought, oh, I can't do that, teenagers are frightening. And my kids were little. I don't know why and how, but I was in a conversation and told, well, what will you do? I think it was him, he was posing the question, or what can you do if you can't do this and you can't do this and you can't do this? And we agreed that I would go to the school and read to the younger children. So I read to 10, 11, 12, 13-year-olds even. And hugely enjoyed it. I was reading aloud at home to my 3-4-year-olds, my 7-year-old, and these youngsters changed me because their responsiveness to the text made it something that I gained from, and it was very sort of self-interested of me. And so today when we recruit volunteers in our library, I'm always trying to help people find their self-interest. It's not about the guilt, because it'll just, you know, sort of either cripple you and stop you from coming or get you to stop again once you show up.
Something they're passionate about and enjoy.
That there has to be something in it for you. I knew that what took me there was my sense that I want to live in a better world than the one we live in. For my children, for myself, I mean, it just doesn't feel safe around here. It's scary. There's a level of sort of constant violence that we appear to be structured into, so that so often we have no choice but to behave violently toward one another. And so I know I want a better world, so that perhaps from that premise, when someone said, what can you do? And I went and read to kids, and then I found that it was an activity that, you know, sort of fed me, just me, not a good thing I did for someone else, but a good thing I did for me. It worked at home with my little middle class kids, my little upper middle class kids. It worked in the school where kids came from. My third book, the one that came out a year ago, Bicycle Dreaming, is set in this waste worker community. The father and the daughter and their relationship in this book, they come from a community of people who
do kabadi work
in Delhi. And the man loses his work, and you know, if there is a bottom, there is yet more bottom than that bottom. So he slides rapidly downhill and starts working with kuda, which is not even the door-to-door kuda, but the landfill where you scavenge. So how that affects the family. So this curiosity or question I've had about, in my own family, if what I have were taken away from me, what would the love I feel for my children look like? And would it be affected? And would I be able to, if I couldn't act on it, to give them the education I'm giving them now, the parks and the games and the tennis classes? What happens to love when it looks different and when it's thwarted, and how much can it be thwarted, and how does the family function? Hmm. I think we blame the family a lot in novels and in our collective thinking about the responsibility the family as a social institution has for providing. So if a child comes unequipped to school, it's because the family has failed the child. So I was curious from when I started working with these youngsters in this read aloud program I was doing in this NGO school about what their home lives look like. So many of them were thriving, is one thing I want to say. That part of my curiosity wasn't just, oh my God, they're suffering and how are they managing? It was actually the thriving. They appeared to be so well loved and so resilient and so able, for example, to hear the stories I was sharing with them from these picture books I was reading to them, and connected to themselves to engage as my kids did, as I have, in that exercise of empathy that literature calls for. They were able to introspect with the stories about, you know, we read a story about Ibn Battuta and he goes and travels all over the world and it happens many centuries ago, and these little kids, many of whom had come from a village and come to a small urban village in Delhi and more or less just lived there. I had a recent experience of doing a field trip, a picnic. Wonderful writer Subhadra Sengupta paid for our library kids, the top readers, to go to Qutub Minar. And we were a little disappointed at the start of the picnic because they said they'd all been there or they'd all seen it before. The question was, have you seen it? And they said yes. And it was only like sort of maybe 20 minutes into the picnic, as we were talking about the history of the monument and so on, they said, yes, humne chhat se dekha. So from their little village that they have not left, they have seen it. But they have seen it in a way that is not the way I've seen it. So that they could look at Ibn Battuta and see themselves in him was, I wouldn't say I was surprised. I don't know what I was, but not exactly surprised. I didn't have assumptions about it, but I had a question about it and they answered the question. And then I wanted to sort of work that out in a book also. And so this family in the book is very similar to the families of the children I read to in 2008. In 2010, the library that we went on to create for the school, there were about 500 children in the school, and we had a library that we created for them so that not just the 24 children who were reading with us in the after school sort of book club, but all 500 kids could once a week borrow a book from the library. That library had to shut down because the school shut down. The NGO shut down in 2013. Not the overall NGO, but the particular school they ran, because when the Right to Education Act passed, this particular school was affected negatively by it. We then took the library and turned it into a community library.
So it was open to adults and children.
And subsequently, we are trying to say in Delhi and in all the parts of India where people don't have access to books and reading, that we need libraries that are free and open to all. And we don't have those. And it's absolutely appalling. Because if you can't read about Ibn Battuta, and if you can't read about Ambedkar, I have a youngster in our library. When you read 80 books in the library, and every child has a reading log, and when I say every child, I should also say we issue nearly 1,000 books a week. We are open for circulation 4 days a week. In a given week, we see about 350 children and adults. In a three-month cycle, we see about 650. In the 2 years we've been open, we've signed up close to 1,400.
Who runs children, the library, Mridula?
Volunteers and members. So the ways in which we are eager to find a model that's replicable requires us to have something relatively inexpensive. So the whole library, serving as many people as it serves in a 400 square foot space, is done by having lots and lots of free labor, and it's teaching the members to run their own, to own and run their own library.
So we have a Bal Panchayat. Okay, all right.
And
tell
our Bal Panchayat are 14 kids, ages about 13 to 19. You have to understand some of them are 10-year-olds when they came onto the Bal Panchayat, because that's who came in the door when we first put a call out for membership. So we started with about 40 members back in January 2015 and in January 2016. 17, we're just chock-a-block with members. And how we do this is we read aloud to the library members in a structured program throughout the week, almost daily. We open books and we read aloud from books. And that is how first-generation readers who are trained hardcore to not think when they're reading, to right. only swallow and regurgitate, or possibly to doze off because it's
rote.
Tediously yeah. boring. That's how we get them to see the great joy in getting this thing turning. Because you know what, they're all thinkers, and we meet them at the door as thinkers, and we tell them, here are books, and if you think with the book, it is a very particular and powerful way to think. You know this, but if you don't have access to books, you actually don't know this. Hmm. You think books are this drudgery that you do and that you must do, and your mom sacrifices for you to go to school to do it so that you can get a job, so that you can get ahead. You also know that all sorts of things aren't working quite right, that that you're not going to, no matter how hard you work at it, necessarily achieve more than this much more. And since you're starting from here, this much more is maybe not even going to be enough. I mean, the 19-year-olds who come in the library, the 25-year-olds who come in the library, they are angry people. And they're looking to books to figure out, why do I feel this way? And what's happened to me?
And is it just my story or the other people like me?
Exactly. What are the, what is the historic dimension to my story? And where else but in a library can a person grapple with this? And how else but by reading and meeting other readers? And how else but by way of these sorts of conversations? That I just don't want us to take for granted that this is happening here today, because this is perilous, this engagement. It's precious because it's endangered. And it's not safe for us either in this world, because so many more don't get to have this. Not 10 or 20 or 30% of this country, but the vast majority of this country is excluded from what you and I are doing here right now.
Yeah.
And it is a political exclusion. It is not a happenstance, coincidental. It is a historic exclusion that has, you know, all sorts of rationale that we need to grapple with. And the best people in many ways to grapple with it is not me in my novel, but all of these people who've been excluded. When they come in and grapple, we're going to have many more answers in this room to the question than we have right now. And that's, you know, that's going to be good for us.
A good point to bring in your third book, Bicycle Dreaming, where, you know, there is this family of Kabadiwalas, the Muhammad and his wife Amina Saidullah, but their daughter Noor is being sent to school. She's being educated, and you're exploring that family. So would you like to read out something from it?
Yeah.
Is it a chapter, the preface? What, you've chosen a passage.
I chose a few different things, and then I thought I'd decide up here.
All right, okay. So, I don't know, something in terms of perhaps Noor and the...
So I'll do a passage that does a little bit of what's happening in Noor's life. The book starts on her birthday, her 13th birthday, and it follows her for exactly a year to the day of her 14th birthday. So she's the daughter of a Kabadiwala. The waste industry is undergoing a lot of changes right now. We are an extraordinary country because we recycle more than almost any other country in this world. We do it because a certain segment of our society, because of caste, is relegated to doing this work generationally, and they still do it. Within that segment, there are more sort of subdivisions, and certain people handle certain kinds of waste, and certain people handle certain other kinds of waste. That coincides with class as well. It coincides with the kind of informal economy that many people occupy and live in. So Muhammad Saidullah is a Kabadiwala. Noor is a 13-year-old girl. she doesn't really know a lot of what's going on in the family's economic life. She's been provided well for. The parents have sacrificed to send her to a small school that they pay maybe like 200 rupees a month for her to attend. It's not a government school. It's something a little better. And there's a huge crisis in the family that's happening without her being able to track a lot of it. On the particular day in which she finds herself having watched her brother sort of fling himself out of the house and say he's not coming back, her older brother is about 21, and her mother leave behind the brother to see what she can do about it. On this day, Noor leaves her home to go find her father. And this is what she sees when she goes chasing him. It's late evening. "What's the matter, little one? Are you lost?" "No," she replied. "I'm looking for my father." Another one of the men tilted his head away from his cup and, looking at her with amusement, asked, "Is your father lost then?" She wondered why everywhere she went, people were in the mood to be funny when the business of her own life was so serious tonight. She decided the inside of her and the outside did not match. Then she wondered if that was true for everyone else as well. And then she wondered that she was wondering this much. "I think a lot," was her conclusion. At which the first man said, "Well, such a serious face. You, I know. You are Mohammed Saidullah's daughter, yes? You will find him in the lane behind where the plastic is sorted. Turn back from where you came with the newspapers. You might find him near where the trucks are parked." It was a compliment, she felt, to be charged with wearing a serious face. There was a pleasure in the idea that this compliment was in some way connected to the fact of her being known here as her father's daughter. Yes, indeed, she was the serious daughter of her serious father, and these men knew it. She hurried to follow the man's directions. Ahead were the trucks the man had spoken of, the trucks she had conjectured would be weighed on the larger weighing scales. These trucks were in process of being loaded, not just with newspapers and tin cans, but with all manner of stuff, ropes and cloth and black serpents, which as she drew nearer, segmented, then came apart to be revealed as tires. One truck was loaded with what glowed in the dark, thousands of plastic canisters, empty of everything except a yellowy light. She stood in amazement in front of it, but could not understand how these ordinary canisters, very much like those she used to bring water home from the communal taps, could be so beautiful. When she circled the truck, she saw what lit them was simply a kerosene lantern. It hung from the roof of a little gunny sack shelter. The men standing underneath it were stooped. The structure was that low. The charpai on which they should have been seated if they had wanted to be comfortable stood empty. Even as she watched, one man backed away from the group. She understood he was backing away from the jabbing finger of one of the other men. The other men advanced as a group. Though he backed out till he had retreated from the structure, this man remained stooped. His stoop was one of apology. His hands were in front of him. They were placed palms together in pleading. She could not hear his words that were spoken softly. But the men who backed him out from the structure and who stood tall outside of it spoke loudly. "What are you accusing us of, Mohammed Saidullah? How can we take advantage of you? You know the trouble we are in. They're putting an incinerator in. This will burn plastic, yes, and it'll burn our business with it. What will be left for us to buy and sell? You can't recycle ashes, can you? You're a lucky man. You have a son who earns. So what if he's throwing his weight around a bit? Go home and show what a father's hand feels like. And then you take it easy, it is your time to rest. Instead, you come here to create trouble for others who have to struggle to make ends meet. Why do you hold your hands out to us? We should be begging from you." The man who spoke last joined his palms together in imitation of Mohammed. Another man joined, laughing harshly. He cut his laugh off abruptly and pushed Mohammed out further into the street. "So the municipal worker has asked you to pay hafta to keep your route, and you decide to point a finger at us? Do you see us getting rich on hafta? If we're getting rich, then what are we doing here buying garbage from you? We have only one piece of advice for you. If you don't want to pay hafta, then make way for those who will. The man you're complaining about who has taken your route, he has a family to feed. As for paying us, that's not hafta. That's the rising cost of doing business. But I paid you, Mohammed cried out. The man who had complained about the plastic incinerator put his hand on Mohammed's shoulder. They looked for a moment like two friends conferring over something mundane. He sent Mohammed sprawling to the street and turned back to the shop. From within the group of men, someone said, "Now why did you do that, Raiz?" But Raiz was already inside the gunny sack shelter, and the others followed him. Noor could not hear the words of the man they left lying on the street, but she could hear the soft hiss of the faraway kerosene lamp. She could not hear his words, but she could feel them inside her. He was speaking of her, something to do with her schooling and with her growing. "My daughter," she imagined him mumble. Why hadn't she noticed that these days, even at home, her father hardly spoke? He only mumbled like this. She wheeled from the scene and went on the other side of the truck full of glowing bottles. She crouched on the ground, trembling, a feeling of panic rising in her, certain only that her father must not see her here. She counseled this panic to subside. "You are 13 years old. You will learn to ride a bicycle. You will show these men." But the panic kept coming, pushing up from inside her till it was in her mouth, a salty taste and thin trickle. She spat. With the spitting, she was released. She ran past the chai stall and the men outside it, through the ghost streets, till she was once again at the entrance of the market.
Wow. This is a great sense of, you've really recreated that scene. I actually work in a slum called Jahangirpuri in Delhi, where there are these kabadiwalas, and we work with the young people there, and you just took me right back there. And but there's a, I mean, yeah, absolutely. I felt I was right there, you know, with them. Tell me, do you have a story about the change that has come about in the children that you worked with in the library? Is there any, you know, one child you would like, you know, you could share something with us?
Well, see, Noor in the book is a very ordinary child. We have this thing when we write literature about the working poor, that they have to somehow qualify to be in literature by way of being, a couple of tropes. One is the extraordinary human being.
Yeah.
Are they extraordinarily gifted of intellect, or maybe a painter, or some artistic ability, or else extraordinarily emotionally sensitive, you know, full of. Noor is not like that. She's just sort of like this very, very ordinary kid. So I want to say she's based a little bit about on the kids I've seen in the library. They are almost all of them very ordinary people. We have adults we serve and we have kids we serve. There are some extraordinary kids. There are some, you know, upper 140s, you know, the kids that, you know, the lights are blazing and it's a joy to be around them, and they could just whip you into shape any day if you got into some sort of a sparring match with them. Their way with words, their command of idiom, their poetic expression if they sit down to write poetry. We do things like 6-week poetry curriculum, writing. We get them listening for a few weeks, then they start writing. This is for the teenagers. We do a lot of wonderful things. And yes, the extraordinary kids rise, but I have to tell you that the library is free and open to all. And it's not just the age and the class. We do run an excellent library. So by the way, some middle and upper middle class kids come, private school kids come to our library. It's aesthetically a beautiful space. We believe we're not only giving books importance, but we believe we're giving the readers and the thinkers coming in the door that importance.
And creating the
right
environment.
When we say it's open to all, we mean it's open to very ordinary people who want to find out who they are and to do it in that very powerful way that books allow them to do it. And it works. I mean, it works with everybody.
Okay.
Parents, we do community walks. We go out and we go door to door every few months. We as the library members go with us. They are our entry ticket in the door, and the volunteers.
Okay.
So these youngsters accompany us, and they're very proud to take us to their homes and so on. And when we go door to door, yes, the parents report to us that
the kids are doing better in school, the kids are, whatever the kids are, I mean, but I think like if a teenager is sitting in a, we do workshops on sexual wellness and gender, and we partner with other NGOs like Breakthrough to do it, because we don't really have the wherewithal to do it ourselves. And then we stalk, we have a shelf of Hindi books, Kishoravastha se Mulaqat, and then we have a adolescence shelf in English also. We have Anne Frank's diary in there. We have all sorts of, so when we do these workshops, I see kids asking, you know, and what is that part called, and is it okay, you know, to trim your pubic hair? I think, like, you know, if you have that question and you can't get an answer for it, it could bother you. I think we're making a difference because we answer questions like that in our books and in our workshops and in opening the door so people can come. These are the questions ordinary people have.
Yes,
and
yes.
It can make an extraordinary difference in our society if we make it possible for people to figure this stuff out.
Great. So on that note, I'm going to open it up for questions here. We have about 10 minutes, I think. So if anyone has questions, could we have the mic there, please? Volunteers? Yeah. Okay. And there's someone in the front row too. Sort of.
Hello. I'm Prachi.
Can you hold it higher? It's on.
Hello, yeah, I'm Prachi, thanks. And I had a very curious question that I'm to a reader, but as being a teenager, I would, you know, would love to know you that what kind of books would you suggest me to read? It's like literature is such a vast subject, you can go beyond anything, you have a lot of texts, but what kind of, you know, literature you would prefer a teenager should read?
So I hope you have access to a library somewhere, even if it's a personal collection or there is a public library system in most towns, and it's so severely limited. We're a city of 20 million in Delhi, and we have about 36 public libraries. So find your way to some place where there's a collection of books. What we do in our library is best practice, which is we have open shelving. And we have all sorts of books categorized, not only by the ease of reading. So we have the patla sahaj kathas, and we have the the katha, which is the thicker ones. And we have our collection includes something like somewhere around 1,000 picture books. If you're not a big reader now, picture books are a great place to start. You'd be amazed at how sophisticated good picture books are and how much they speak even to adults. They're actually written mostly as a genre or category of books. They're written for adults to read to children. So if they're not going to prove to be boring for the adult reading to the child, the author's going to have to write the kind of book that's appealing to adults too. So in fact, picture books are very appealing to adults.
But I think she wanted to know what you would suggest that she reads.
See, because I don't know you, I'm trying to suggest that you go find out what appeals to you, and be open to the possibility of finding what appeals to you anywhere across the library. It's really about going and being able to look at books. Part of finding yourself in a library isn't just reading a book and finding yourself inside that specific book.
Yeah.
It's about finding yourself somewhere in the library. Are you a nonfiction reader? Are you a pulp fiction reader? Are you I like a racy story and I want to get to the end and I want to be transported and I want to sort of, you know, feel, are you maybe a reader of erotica? You know, I want my, you know, sort of juices stirred.
Yeah.
This is something you find out only by going there and actually opening yourself to reading a variety of different things. I always tell the kids in our library who keep borrowing the same kind of book, you know, next week, maybe not today, or the week after, try something new and see. You know, I don't ever see you in the nonfiction section. We have amazing books about volcanoes. Try it. And, you know, if I have a relationship with the member, sometimes they do try it. And sometimes I'm right. They should have tried it. They find something they hadn't known existed in the world, something that speaks to them. So try things is what I'm trying to say.
Hi, so my name is Danish. And
just talk a little louder into the mic.
Yeah, so thank you for this, and I think your work is quite incredible. And I think my question comes from that, because the reason that you have to do this at all is because there's so much state apathy on one level, right? Because we have library legislations which are completely ignored, where the state should be imposing library tax or cess and then providing money to public libraries, but we hardly have public libraries in the first place.
True.
So I guess one of my questions was, have you had any engagement with the state on this front, whether in terms of advocacy or whether in terms of trying to garner resources? And the second one was just kind of, I mean, as an offshoot of that question, so what are the really popular texts in your libraries? Are there any, are there any really unlikely books which really capture the imagination? So just, yeah.
So the books that work really well in our library, I'll start backward with your questions, are like Pratham books, Katha books, Tulika books. Again, they're mostly picture books, although some of these publishers, like Katha, for example, has slightly thicker picture books. There's a I think it's O.V. Vijayan, Malayalam language writer, in translation into Hindi by Katha. Our teenagers have had this book read aloud to them. I'm sorry, I don't remember the title of the book anymore. But it's a story of a man who's extraordinarily agitated, leaving his home in a village, getting on a train and going somewhere. And you're wondering as the reader, why is he? It has this hideous level of suspense. You feel so anxious for this man. He is going to, as we find out later in the story, meet his son in jail. His son is serving the last day of his sentence because he's awaiting execution on the next, and then last page of the story, the father. So this is a picture book written for younger children, and it's by an extraordinary writer, renowned in Kerala, in translation in Hindi. So people like Katha, people like Pratham are doing this amazing work, and we have those books, and those books appeal to our members. The state and what it hasn't done. Periodically, the state tries to do libraries, and they do such a poor job. Aside from the fact that they don't do enough libraries, they don't do what their mandate is, they also, when they open libraries, don't follow best practice. Mm. They don't read aloud. You see, like, I didn't know all this when I started out. Our library is a learning lab in some senses. We're trying to figure out how do we transform first-generation non-readers into readers. That means their parents didn't read. That means they go to school to learn to read, but they don't know that reading can do this other thing for them, that they can think when they're reading. So how we do that transformation is through reading with them. This is completely absent in all of our library programs, whether in our government schools or in our private schools or in the government-run public library system. Or, you know, like the Aam Aadmi Party is talking about mohalla libraries. They're not going to do the right kind of library. So some of what we're trying to do is create an example of what a library should look like. There are people out there who have done variations on what we're doing. Some of them, I disagree with the things they've done. For example, a tiered membership system. In a tiered membership system, somebody pays 3,000 rupees a month and takes home 6 books at a time. Somebody pays 1,000 and takes home 4 books at a time. Somebody pays 200 for just a reading fee to come in and read. Somebody, because of proving themselves, you know, whatever, not having that kind of income, is free. And supposedly this is anonymous. Well, it is not anonymous to the person who is purchasing the free membership and signing up for it. They know that they are free and other people are not. They know they are excluded from this project and other people are not. Mm. The kids who come to our library know that some people live in houses with running water and that they don't. You know, people are not stupid. Everybody is a thinking human being and they are thinking about this stuff. So when we say you come into our library and everybody here is welcome, that means truly everybody. Nobody is more welcome or less welcome than anybody else. So nobody pays more for access to more books and nobody pays less or free for access to less books. So these kinds of best practices, they need to get out there, and we hope to be sort of an example. We're trying to provide a small good thing as a way for people to discuss, and then using that as a platform. So we serve our 800 to 1400 members, depending on how you count numbers, to write grant proposals and so on. But ultimately, we are also sort of using ourselves as a way to talk about this experience.
Great, we have time for just one more question.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Patricia Ford. I'm Irish, I'm from Ireland. And I totally agree with you on so many things that you said, especially about reading aloud and picture books. But I wanted to just tell you briefly, in Ireland we also have a lot of these problems, but our libraries now are totally free. But one scheme we do, which I think would be is really working very well for us, is we do a thing called children's book doctors. And it involves writers usually going into places like supermarkets, and they're dressed as doctors, and the child comes over and we talk to them to try and find out what kind of book they might enjoy, and then we write them a prescription to take with them, like your teenager who asked the question, what should I read? And we found that going into our communities to places like shopping centres, we could access ordinary children who mightn't be brought to libraries. So I just thought that
so
was...
So depending on that chit, it gives you a reference of the kind of books you
yes.
want to stop.
But you know, it's like when you're trying to... If you do want to make the world a better place, sometimes I'm a writer and I find I can't do anything very practical. I couldn't build a house. I couldn't cure a child who was sick. But I think this is one thing writers can do, and we volunteer to do this and go and recommend books to young people.
Oh, that's wonderful. Do we wrap up? I'm afraid we've run short of time. Okay, unless we keep it, okay, really short, you'll have to, your answer would have to be also brief, all right.
Yeah, it's very short. Like, ever since you left this country and then came back, what is the change which actually is, what hasn't changed and you feel good about, positive about it, and you want it to continue?
So to keep it short, I think I grew up in a Nehruvian India, and there was some engagement around the idea that as a society, we were not going to, as Arundhati Roy said, cannibalize ourselves. We are cannibalizing ourselves. What's happening in Bastar or in Kashmir is unconscionable. Thank you for this platform, because I get to say these things. I write books so I can say these things. We are not a better country today than we used to be. And we're lying to ourselves if we say that we are shining, or that we've found our place in the, and we're looking to get on the Security Council. We're happy to talk to nuclear arms dealers so that we can buy that seat. This is all kinds of wrong. And I want more people participating in these conversations so that we can say, you know, let's take this country back. Let's have it serve more of us than it does. A more democratic country.
Thank you, Mridula. Talking about India shining, you know, you've been working with the India simmering part of it.
Thank
and thank you for inspiring. And thank you. Thanks, Arun.
Ladies and gentlemen of Sambad, please thank once again Mridula Koshy and Puneeta Roy for a fantastic Freedom to Dream session. Mridula will be doing a short book signing just at our author signing tent, which is just out to my right behind the tent here. If you don't have a copy of one of her books, you can purchase those from the bookshop, which is just down in front of Chaba. A few announcements regarding this evening. There's some more fantastic music happening down at Hotel Clark's Amer at 7 p.m. this evening. If you'd like to get tickets, you can purchase those from registration tent number 2 just outside or at the venue. The next session here will begin very shortly. It is session 51C, which is a book launch of Farmer Falgu Goes Kite Flying, which will begin in 10 minutes. Thank you.